Thankful to the dignitaries from the government, especially the Honorable Minister of Finance, for joining us today to discuss this very crucial issue of greening our industry. MCCI, as the voice of responsible business in the country, has taken up this issue seriously and is very pleased to partner with the Asia Foundation today to organize this seminar as a stepping stone towards formulating a green industrial policy appropriate for Bangladesh. This requires technology transfer and capacity building and investment at the enterprise level. At the national level, this will require fiscal and other incentives, policy guidelines, and regulatory framework and implementation. We urge upon the government of Bangladesh to immediately set up a dedicated green funding agency manned by qualified personnel who can offer the one-stop service required as well as low-cost, long-term funds for the capital expenditure needed to adopt more environmental-friendly processes, such as zero discharge or higher cost to make cradle-to-cradle products, as was inspired by Walter Stadel in the 70s. I personally work in the footwear industry, and today, when we export footwear from Bangladesh, we are required to certify that the shoelaces that we use have metal tips. And the metal tips cannot come from specific mines in Congo, because Congo is not an acceptable trading partner for the United States of America, and we export our product there. So that is the level of traceability in terms of environmental standard. I'll give you a second example, sir, from the furniture industry, which is one of our trust sector industries and doing very well. If you manufacture furniture for export, we have to be able to certify that the wood is not coming from Amazon clear forests and are coming from sustainable reforested plantations. For the textile industry, we have a pioneer here, Mr. Kutubuddin Ahmed. We're talking about traceability of cotton. We're talking about ethical cotton sourcing. So today we are extremely excited and privileged to have two presenters here on this topic. One is a possible strategy for a green industrial policy with examples of international best practices by renowned researcher Dr. Fahmida Khatun of CPD. Another one is a case study by Dr. Yusuf of Dhaka University on the analysis of incentives for greening the RMG sector specifically in Bangladesh. The two presentations will be followed by responses from a very eminent panel consisting of leading business, legal, technical and policy practitioners from the industry. Finally, of course, in conclusion, we shall have the privilege of hearing the views of the Honorable Finance Minister and the other important policymakers present here on this topic. I would like to conclude my remarks by thanking you all once again for your kind attention. Thank you very much.
The Asia Foundation has a very long history in Bangladesh that goes back to our founding in 1954. For several decades, it has been our good fortune to work with a wide range of incredibly talented and dedicated leaders in government, civil society, the private sector, and the academic and research community to address some of the Bangladesh's most critical development issues, particularly in the areas of good governance, economic reform, women's empowerment, and regional cooperation. Asia Foundation supports Asian initiatives for improved economic governance, conducive business environments and regional and global economic cooperation to expand trade and investment and ensure greater economic opportunities for all. The Foundation's long-standing presence, broad geographic reach and trust with key actors position the Foundation to make important contributions to improve relations with different stakeholders. Against this backdrop, the Asia Foundation, in collaboration with Metropolitan Chamber of Commerce and Industry and Center on Budget and Policy, is implementing this project titled Promoting Green Industrial Policy for Bangladesh, Opportunities and Challenges. As one of the most vulnerable countries in the world to climate change due to its low-lying geography, high population density, and persistent poverty, Bangladesh faces severe challenges to its ability to sustain its economic development. Its focus on following a traditional development trajectory has its own environmental consequences. And without reconciling the economic and the environmental pillars, economic growth will not be sustainable. Adopting and applying green growth policies offers a solution. Launch the concept, a national coalition that can encourage business ideas related with green growth opportunities and advocate for policies related with green growth by engaging the private sector and public sector actors in research and dialogues. With endorsement from Metropolitan Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Asia Foundation is privileged to undertake this important project and to co-host today's event. We firmly believe in the importance and strength of working in coalition with key stakeholders such as MCCI and the government in formulating green industrial policy for Bangladesh, and appreciate the opportunity to continue the work with MCCI and others. I would like to thank all the participants and the respective organizations for their participation and valuable input in making this workshop a success. I hope together we'll be able to transform the economy of Bangladesh into a green economy and thus benefiting everyone living in this country. And finally, I would like to thank our invited guests and the organizers for their wholehearted support and cooperation, and our Honorable Finance Minister for gracing the occasion. Thank you very much.
We all know that industries are essential to economic growth of any country because they're instrumental in the provision of food, transport, technologies, infrastructure, housing, and other goods and services. However, many industries use more materials and energy than their production process required. As you know, that every economic activity has its pitfalls. As countries have progressed, they have also generated various emissions because of the production style, consumption pattern. So industry is one of the sectors also which not only make production, produces goods and services, but it also emits. And this is due to the use of obsolete and inefficient technologies and also methodologies, apart from the policies. And both producers and consumers have adopted patterns of production and consumption that do not take into consideration the limits to growth. Because what are the limits to growth? The planet has limited resources, and the assimilative capacity of the planet for emission is also limited. And these two problems are complicated by the growing population, because the earth has a limited capacity, and when population grows, obviously production and consumption also increases. And the current production system are therefore unsustainable, and as you know that sustainability is something which do not allow, which actually produce it in a manner that it does not jeopardize the ability of future generations to meet their demands or requirements. So green industry is an industrial policy that produce and develop that does not come at the expense of the health of natural systems or lead to adverse human health outcomes. And the basic objectives of green industry include mainstreaming environmental, climate and social considerations into the operations of enterprise. As you know that over the years, sustainable development has taken the center place for economic development. And last year, in September, when the United Nations adopted sustainable development goals, the three pillars of these goals were economic, environmental, and social. So you can see that environmental issues has actually taken have been taken into consideration very seriously because of its implications. On the other hand, the share of industry has increased from 23% in 1995 to 30.4%. So there's a basic structural structural change in the economy. And as you can see that the projections of the structural change of Bangladesh economy, as has been mentioned in the perspective plan of Bangladesh, is that by 2021 we have a different scenario in terms of the structure of the economy. Obviously the industrial contribution of the industrial sector will further increase, and the agricultural importance of agricultural sector will reduce. I want to highlight a few initiatives of the government of Bangladesh which have been environment related policies. There have been many environment related policies, as you see that environmental policies, most of which are locally created. So the government has taken, we can see a host of policies and agreements and for and rules, and also some of the other strategies. Most significant is that the national conservation strategy, and then Bangladesh, and apart from these strategies, I also want to highlight that the government has also formed, established a fund, Green Climate Trust Fund, Bangladesh Climate Change Trust Fund, BCCT, and also other policies. So greening of industries is basically a cross-cutting exercise. It's not only about the industry sector itself, and it's not about the industrial policy itself, because unless you have an overarching policy or integrated policy, a single, you know, standalone industrial policy cannot green the industry or green the economic part. So it has a range of policy streams: industrial policy, environmental policy at the center, and also the regional development policies. So green industry policies of the broad range of government, it requires a broad range of government interventions which directly or indirectly support the greening of industries. Now, how do we achieve that? It also requires the policy mix that combines carrot and stick approach. That is, you take market-based initiatives and also incentives and also awareness raising. Now I'll move on to present a tentative policy framework for greening industries in Bangladesh. Basically, this policy framework is based on five themes. First one is an integrated framework for supporting the greening of industries. Here we propose that if the commitment has to come from the top levels of the government. We see that the five-year plans, then poverty reduction plans or various sectoral plans, so all these will have to have a vision for greening the economy, and the strategy has to be very high level, and the objective for sustainable development, poverty reduction and sustainable consumption and production, and setting up of regulatory frameworks. It should include market-based, regulatory, voluntary and information-based instruments, and instrument mix which are flexible and also broad-based. If we have, you have carrots, but you have to also take into consideration the capacities of various industries. In the industry sector, there are big industries, but also there are small and medium enterprises. So given their capacities, the policies and the measures have to be flexible. Therefore, green industry is the sector strategy for realization of the green economy and ultimately sustainable development. Thank you very much.
So before that, if we look at our economy, that is our GDP growth rate, Bangladesh is working on the path of on an average 6.5% growth over last, I think, one decade. And also, not only that, if we look at the fiscal policy and monetary policy, we have consistent growth with equality, also our Gini coefficient also decreasing. And also if you look at the other macroeconomic indicator, that is which is very, very important, that's inflation is also below at the 6% rate. If you look at the export figures, that is in the last completed financial year, we received 34 $0.24 billion as export earnings. But the main drivers of these export earnings, ready-made garments industry, contributing a lot. If we look at the policy level, you know, the 7th 5-year plan or our national budget document or industrial policy, government significantly and greatly acknowledged the importance of environmental friendly industry. So it's a positive sign from the perspective of government. And that's why we think that the current study focusing on greening ready-made garments is a timely initiative and which is extremely important for sustainable development in the context of Bangladesh. But why? There are some research questions what behind this study. Because we want to know, because if we want to compete along with our competitive countries like Vietnam, China, so we need to know what is the current state of knowledge about the green growth among the industries. What is the, what's their perception, how they define it, and also what the policy incentive or policy support required, what the factory owners, what the other policy makers, they think about the green industry. So keeping in that mind, we conducted this study with the support from Asia Foundation. But having said this, this is not enough. There is no specific strategic action plans to promote green growth, so hence we still need specific rules and regulations. But how the ready-made garments defines green growth? We notice that there is a clear understanding among the factory owners about the green growth, that is the compliance issues, said by the Minister of Environment, and also compliance issues said by the buyers. But green growth is more than compliance issues. So there is a common understanding among the factory owners, particularly those who are high achievers in the ready-made garments industries. And also, it is all about attaining LEED certification. The garments owners, they are aware about this. And also, they are working, they are using, constructing their buildings with green materials, they are focusing on energy and water efficiency, and also we have noticed a comprehensive business model, particularly those who are the high achievers. Mr. Kutubuddin is here. We have seen when we had a long interview with him. It's not that only just business matters, it's social issues, it's social benefit, employee welfare, and other issues also related on this. And we are happy to say that Bangladesh is the home of the first environment-friendly knit factory in the world. Bangladesh is the home of number one denim textile industry in the world. So we feel proud of them among the other LEED certified, particularly gold and platinum certified factory. So as a whole, we have seen that there is a clear idea about the green growth. We have seen lots of enthusiasm, interest in the policies circle about the concept, but there is a challenge that how to transform the policy guidelines into specific rules, regulations, and specific actions. So there's a need for evidence-based policy making to encourage the whole sector, not a particular group of factory owners. And also, even though finance is really important, and there is no, at this moment Bangladesh Bank, there is a green financing opportunity provision in Bangladesh Bank. I know there is a green financing general manager from Bangladesh Bank here, he will update us. But there are a number of limitations because existing rate is 9%. It is not a market rate based. So we need to focus on the what is the market based rate. If it is 9%, there is no difference we will make. I think our Honorable Finance Minister here, so we need to look at how we can attract the new factory owners who are willing to make their industries green, and how do we make them, provide them financial support with a subsidized rate of interest. You know that if we want to set up, or someone want to set up green factories, mean spending extra money compared to traditional traditional factories, it requires extra cost of 10 to 20% more. So, government does not have, at this moment, strategic action plans to promote green industries or fiscal incentive, but now it is a time to think of fiscal incentive. We can help for the research support, we can give the research support, and we can expect technical support, technical assistance from an organization like Asia Foundation to build necessary capacity to support green growth. I think if we focus on the green industrial policy and the vision 2021, that is to see Bangladesh as a middle income countries, to see Bangladesh as a green Bangladesh, the dream will be fulfilled in the near future. Thank you very much. Thank you for your question.
Very important point that she made, that greening of industry will not be possible, sir, by industrial policy alone. I think it is not possible by any policy alone. This requires multi-sectoral, multi-government implementation, not just one. And of course, the five pillars of the policy framework that she talked about, which I will not repeat. Looking at the South Korean example of how they pursued manufacturing-led, export-led industrial growth, at the same time promoting industrial growth and green growth. However, the fact remains that we do have 28 factories which have achieved LEED certification and 100 more factories in the pipeline. This is, of course, a good move. A very important fact about, there is no price incentive from buyers at the moment. And the hope, Mr. Qutbuddin, I'm sure we'll talk about it, is for the future. So for the champions like Envoy, of course, these are investments, for the future. But for the newcomers and for the middle of the road, how do they survive long enough? Or even for the champions, these costs are very high. Something I'm sure we talk about is the cost of the Bangladesh Bank refinance window, the 9% of which Bangladesh Bank, we understand, takes 1%. 4% is for the Ministry of Finance, and commercial banks take a 4% spread to give money for us to conserve our planet and our country. How logical and rational is this? And of course, finally, do we need indeed a green industrial policy? And if we do, the importance of multi-sectoral consultation and of course having more dialogue, which is what this today's seminar is all about. So with this quick wrap up, I would like to now request our very distinguished panel of discussants to give us their responses to the paper and to the topic today. May I request Dr. Atik Rahman, Executive Director of BCS, to start with his comments. And if you could restrict your comments to about 5 to 7 minutes, that would be great.
Thank you. So that was like the early awareness and acceptance phase of new skills. Then the whole technological development was taking place and people understood the effluent treatment plant, assessment of measured goods. The waste that comes out from the garment industry is one of the volatile substances which create a lot of tension in the local area of various reasons. Compliance. Environmental compliance very simply means in the electric flow, where is the weakness, where is the leakage, and how they can improve it. And they can improve anything between 10 to 30% of savings just by getting the right type of system and making sure the right flow continues. This is not, you know, rocket science. This is not even an electrical engineer's job. This is some electrician who can measure what is the voltage here, what is the amperage there, how much current flows, etc. Anybody who says after 1990 that they don't have the knowledge cannot be justified. So we have the knowledge now. And Bangladesh has made a commitment in Paris World Conference on Climate Change in what is called INDC, intended nationally declared, nationally determined contribution of our carbon or our greenhouse gas into the global kitty. And our promise has been that we can reduce 10% without any additional funding, because we have a huge loss across the system, I could add, but that's not the best place. I hope the government will give us the leadership that we deserve, and the chambers who do the needful, civil society, engineers, other consultants, backup systems, we should develop that skill because that skill has to be, is required. Many of you know that from garment and textile industry, about $3 billion goes out of the country as salaries of expatriate experts that work here. So that half of it could come to Bangladeshi expert. Why not? So that is the type of skill that we should develop. Thank you very much for
that. We started, this journey was not very easy. We started 4 or 5 years back, and it involved around more than $1 million. But we accept the concept and we carried on. And we had a lot of hiccups in between. The consultant was not available here, so we hired foreign consultant, and slowly but steadily we worked on. Means we take care of our own discharge in our own lake. We have dig out the lake, big lake which can store 30 million liters of water. If you compare with the Singapore, the total quantity could be supply for 1 week, whole Singapore. So this lake particularly, we have the fish farming as well, and on the bank and the edge, we cultivate vegetables, which is used for our workers, those who are staying in the dorm. Mostly 100% workers are staying at our dorm. So, and the ETP discharge also, it goes straight to the lake, including the rainwater. We harvest 100% rainwater from our land area, which is around 130 bigas of land in Bhaluka. So this water we preserve, and this ETP, this wastewater, we use for toilet flush, not to open the tap, not to use waste the water. They put it, and they don't, they teach them not to put on the plug on the source every time, that will consume some sort of electricity. So these are the things, I mean, from the boyhood they learn.
Environmental sustainability receives high priority in the policies of Bangladesh Bank. Accordingly, Bangladesh Bank has undertaken and implemented a good number of initiatives to help implement energy and environment related programs to the government. To ensure the development of sustainable or green economy, private sector financing in sustainable sector is also essential in association with public sector financing. In 2009, Bangladesh Bank launched a green revolving refinance scheme with an initial focus on solar energy, biogas and waste heat wind plant. Its scope has continuously been expanded and now covers 50, shifting the investment from fossil fuel to green energy is the only way of transforming economic growth paths. Assessment of environmental risks beyond, that is above a threshold limit, is a must. The high time for the banks and financial institutions to play a proactive role with the basic theme, that environmental risk assessment and credit risk assessment are the major two players for the safety and sustainability of the overall credit. And I would like to see a green revolution through a proactive and effective management engagement between green industry and financial sector for attaining a sustainable inclusive growth. I'd like to express my sincere gratitude to the Honorable Chief Guest and others guests, to the organizers for organizing this seminar, timely and fruitful event.
And one of the significant things that in Bangladesh that we need to look at for this is actually zoning. Unfortunately, we have zoning on paper, but when it comes to practice, it never gets implemented. So industrial zoning in every upazila, district and division is absolutely essential. Otherwise, we will see continuation of this erratic placement of production facilities, which will make it difficult for any policy framework to be effective.
Green industrial policy actually cannot be implemented in Indonesia. It requires well-conceived, consistent, well-coordinated approach, and the approaches actually by which we can bring forth the desired improvement. I was reading an article of the chief economist of World Bank where two approaches were preferred for ensuring green growth, industrial growth. One is sunrise and the other is sunset policy. We will have to first of all decide what approaches we should be following in furthering the greening process of the industries of our country. Done. What are the strategies to be taken to take the process forward? That will be a nice document, of course. System of periodical inspection of the factories about implementation of the industry greening measures to be embodied. Penalties for the breaches of conditions to be included. How will the existing industries with unfavorable impact on the environment will be technologically be made green to be prescribed? A clear specification will also be there in respect of non-issuance of the license to the industries without completing the agri of the greening rules. But these are actually the benefits that can come up. Opportunities are there, but challenges are there. Taking firm stand at the decision takers and implementers level to implement the decision is a big challenge. This all measures may help implement the process. Now, as to the...
Mr. Zakir, you have to wrap up in 1 minute.
Okay, thank you. Mutual Trust Bank has done a lot in implementing the policy of the green finance policy. Mutual Trust Bank has given credits in various fields where there is emphasis from the Bangladesh Bank and also the government. In Mutual Trust Bank, we have already financed...
Mr. Zakir, I'm sorry, I have to cut you off. Do you have anything to say about the two papers?
Okay. So, from West Tyre, by the process, by a different process. So we have involved ourselves meaningfully. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Zakir. Can I now request Mr. Zia Rahman, Managing Director?
Strong leadership and strong determination to really implement these projects, because if you want to buy a machine which has less power consumption, less environment hazardous, it always costs more. So I always remember my senior brother, and I respect him a lot, Honorable our Mr. Manjur, Nasim Bhai, that he always tells me, Zia, the industry is like a chicken and egg situation. So whichever he wants to. So if you want to survive, you have to really invest. So I always follow that advice. So my practical experience, I just want to wrap up. It is when we started the factory for the footwear, and we want to be a model factory so that it can be example for the rest of our footwear industry, which is the second largest contribution to our economy. And I think it's a very potential in this industry, because it's a very similar to RNG, and we have almost 23 million young hands which can contribute to produce. And since our government is very determined for a new leather part, so this leather can be converted to a product, and it can be increase a significant number of our foreign currency exchange. And our association is already we have a target for 5 billion turnover, and I hope that we will be achieve inshallah. And my experience is that when we are setting up the footwear industry, I approached we were doing the banking in the public bank, and it was very unfortunate that the public bank was saying us to that it is not possible for us to access to the green financing to the Bangladesh banks, which is the fund was related to them, because I don't know, for some reason they were not being accessible to that. So we had to invest by our own self for almost $2 million US dollar for improve our facilities. So that is one experience I have, which is I think that our Bangladesh Bank are to move fast. And I think that most of the things our previous speakers they already covered. So I just think that we are in the right track. we have some hiccup, and the world is always there is hiccup, but I am being a young entrepreneur, I am very seeing a very bright future for Bangladesh, and I hope this type of dialogues and things need to be really encouraged and to do it more to really find a better solution for our future and preserve the country. Thank you very much.
I already have a request for the first speaker, Mr. Mohammad Mohiuddin Sheikh, General Secretary of Bangladesh Washing Owners Association.
আমার দাবি ছিল এবিসিসিতে দাবি ছিল এবং এবিসিসি জেনারেল মিটিং এও মতলুব সাহেবের কাছে দাবি ছিল এবং এর আগে কাজী আকরামউদ্দিন সাহেব যিনি স্ট্যান্ডার্ড ব্যাংকের চেয়ারম্যান ছিলেন এবং এক্সিম ব্যাংকের চেয়ারম্যান ছিলেন সবার কাছে আমরা বারবার দাবি করে আসছি কিন্তু আমরা যে এই যে আজকে যে গুণীজনের এখানে সংগঠিত হয়েছে আমার দাবি আমরা যদি আমরা সরকারের পক্ষ থেকে বা আমাদের দেশের যে সচিব মহোদয় আছেন এখানে শ্রী আমি ইন্ডাস্ট্রি আমি টঙ্গি বিসিকে দেখেন ওই টঙ্গি বিসিকে হাঁটু পানি জমে যেত যখন ই হতো বৃষ্টি বর্ষা হতো আমি বারবার বলার পরও বিসিক থেকে আমরা কোনো হেল্প পাইনি আমরা নিজস্ব অর্থায়নে 12 কোটি টাকা খরচ করে আমরা রাস্তা ড্রেন করেছি তা আমরা কি এই এই গ্রিন ইন্ডাস্ট্রি করার জন্য বা লিড ফ্রি ইন্ডাস্ট্রি করার জন্য সরকার থেকে অন্তপক্ষে কমপক্ষে না হলেও ব্যাংকের ট্রাস্ট যদি কমক আর না কমুক আমাদের ইটিপির যে খরচটা আছে এই খরচটা আরো নিম্ন হারে যাতে দেওয়া যায় সেই জন্য আপনাদের সবার কাছে আমি বিনয়ের সাথে অনুরোধ করছি ধন্যবাদ সবাই
You need 25 to 26 thousand tons of coal. For HSK, our current project, you need about 30 to 40 tons of coal. So that to that extent reduce the atmospheric pollution. 15 times more. That is the point. But the point that the other advantage also. Because they can produce a whole of 4 years. There's no interruption. And then they produce a 1.5 million fixed kiln produces CER of 5,000 tons. Now, World Bank, in our case, in the case I mentioned, they gave $15 per ton of CER. $15 per ton of CER. They said they can't. Market rate is only hard to $1 now. I don't think. And then the ADB has taken over. It's okay, fine. World Bank. And we said we pay $8.
Mr. Nasrul Hasan, Vice President of the Leather Goods and Footwear Exporters Association, and then Mr. Nisupar.
CO2 emissions. Industrial policy, biggest issue of change, environmental climate change, because of CO2. But you see the major producers of CO2 are not bothered. USA is even importing LNG and reserving it under the to use this, which will always produce CO2. Shutaran Amazon, of course, CO2 report reduction at the cost of Japan, that will not be used. And that will not help the world because CO2 is not a country specific, it is national, international. CO2 got there worldwide, so our industry should not suffer any energy cost disadvantage. Because you cannot be holier than one.
I that it is different disclosure. I want to know that ETP, absence of ETP in many of the industries, causing damage to our environment, and the government has to offset this damage through this budgetary allocation. So I believe that we should have some study how our.
যদি ইন্ডাস্ট্রিকে গ্রিন করতে বলা হয় তাহলে ইন্ডাস্ট্রিকে হ্যান্ডেল করতে হবে এবং সেচ প্রকল্পে গেলে ওই সেচ প্রকল্পের জন্য কিন্তু আমাদের বিদ্যুৎ ইউজ করতে হতো, তাহলে সেচের জন্য যদি পানি যেত তাহলে দেখা যেত ইন্টিগ্রেটেড ওয়েতে এই সেচ প্রকল্পটা আমাদের উঠে যাবে এলাকা ভিত্তিক, তাহলে এখানে আমাদের কিন্তু বিদ্যুৎ খরচ কম হতো। সুতরাং এই এই জায়গাতেও বিদ্যুৎ ইয়েও হতো না। এটা হচ্ছে আমার দুই নম্বর পয়েন্ট। থার্ড নম্বর পয়েন্ট যে আমাদের যদি ট্যাক্স বেনিফিট না দেওয়া হয় বা কিছু ক্ষেত্রে ট্যাক্স বেনিফিট না দেওয়া হয় তাহলে খারাপ যে করতেছে আর ভালো যে করতেছে তাদেরকে একইভাবে ট্রিট করা হচ্ছে, তাহলে যারা খারাপ করছে তারা তো ভালো বেশি বেশি ভালোভাবে ট্রিটেড হচ্ছে, যারা ভালো করছে তাদের কিন্তু ভালোভাবে ট্রিট করা হচ্ছে না। এখানে আমার এই জাস্ট এই তিনটা পয়েন্ট আমার।
এনভায়রনমেন্টাল পলিসিটাকে ইন্টিগ্রেট না করা যায় তাহলে দেখা যাবে যে মাল্টিনেশনাল কোম্পানিজ আর গোইং টু পে ফর দ্য প্রাইস হোয়ার অ্যাজ দ্য লোকাল কোম্পানিজ আর
মাচ মোর দ্যান দ্যাট এন্ড ইট ইজ অ্যাবাউট অ্যান এন্টায়ার প্রসেস ইন আ ফ্যাক্টরি অ্যাজ ওয়েল অ্যাজ ইটস সাপ্লাই চেইন। নাও গ্লোবাল সাপ্লাই চেইন ইজ আ হট টপিক অ্যাট দ্য ইন্টারন্যাশনাল লেভেল টুডে। দেয়ার ওয়াজ আ হিউজ ডিবেট লাস্ট জুন in the International Labour Organization, and this was actually the first of a number of debates that's going to follow. Now, global aspirations are directed towards stringent compliance requirements concerning social and environmental requirements and needs. If we are to remain engaged in the global supply chain, and there is no way out for Bangladesh, we have to, I don't think we have a choice but to work towards greening our factories and operations. Besides, it is also apparent that it makes economic sense to go for greening of the factories. Now, the main issue over here is who pays for greening of factories. Buyers are not willing to pay, as has been said by a number of earlier speakers. At least for the moment, we have to do it ourselves. Therefore, in order to fast track bringing our factories and operations, our enterprises will need low cost funds, low cost green funds, and government will have to come up with proactive steps in order to offer fiscal and policy support for our enterprises. Thank you very much.
First is, I have a specific question for the Bangladesh Bank. You mentioned the GTF, $200 billion. How much has been disbursed? Any metalwork factory does not have the same ability to pay as an export-oriented textile factory. So we have to find an equitable method of how to do this. The third point, sir, is that there is a lot of talk about how the practicalities of environmental treatment. Let's talk about sludge disposal. I was hoping someone would talk about this. Most environmental treatment plants, ETPs, generate a lot of sludge. Now, it is not possible for a lot of factories to have 130 bigas of land like Envoy. It's not possible. So where will the sludge go? Where is the disposal? Where is the sludge policy for Bangladesh? If factories generate sludge, they are not allowed to dump it in municipal sludge pits. Every country in the world, developed country, developing, has sludge disposal sites. I was hoping there would be a representative of the Department of Environment at this seminar. I'm sorry to say I don't see any, unless you identify yourself. Once again, it shows the lack of, shall we say, coordination. So this is something that we need more. We need more coordination with the actors. And last but not least, sir, there is a lot of talk about how the next war will not be, if it is for oil, but it will be for water. And the next global war will not be for oil, but will be for water. And Bangladesh has tremendous quantities of water. We are naturally blessed. However, we have also serious challenges to contamination of groundwater through unplanned industrialization. Here, I could not agree more with Munawar. Sir, industrial zoning is and has to be done if you want to control this. Otherwise, no amount of seminars is going to be done. So with that, I will hand over to our special guest, Mr. Mohammad Musharraf Hussain Bhuiya, for his contribution, and then we will hear from Archik.
I hope it was a very enjoyable and fruitful discussion. Adoption of planned approach to green growth is linked with a number of economic and social development policies. The benefits and costs of green growth and trade-offs between its components, that is, economic growth, social inclusion, and environment and climate resilience, are therefore also significantly related to socio-economic development of the country. It is evident that the green growth policies promote long-run growth in GDP through minimizing the costs of climate change as well as developing new sectors, creating employment, trade and competitive benefits. I'm happy to say that government is well aware about the potential of green growth, and we have taken a number of initiatives to support the industries that are moving towards going green. Both the 7th 5-year plan, 2016-20, and the perspective plan of Bangladesh 2010-21 have green growth components and focus on incorporation of climate and environment into development planning process, coastal zone management, and afforestation. The Planning Commission is working on developing a sustainable development action plan, which will consider the significance of green growth in developing the country's development strategies to achieve the 2030 vision for attaining sustainable development goals. In addition, as a central framework for climate change planning, the Climate Change Strategy and Action Plan, together with National Adaptation Program of Action, includes a number of green growth policy themes. For example, establishing macroeconomic implications of climate change resulting in the establishment of dedicated climate funds. And not only the government is instrumental in this respect, the private sector initiatives are also very important in this respect. The government of Bangladesh is well aware of the fact that a number of countries has developed green industrial policies, and our government, under the leadership of the Honorable Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, is more than willing to do whatever we can promote for the green industries. Protecting environment while maintaining economic growth has always been the key focus of the current administration, and I can assure you that government will proactively work for introducing green industrial policy in Bangladesh by working together with the industrial sectors in the force to protect the green industrial policy for Bangladesh. I thank all of the participants and the media for listening my address. Thank you.
I will explain the reason why I asked it. When I became very conscious about the environment in the 80s, particularly after the report of Brundtland report on sustainable development. At that time, Mr. Leontief Versteeg and I, the main titan of the mathematical economics, and we produced an estimate over a very short period of time as to what it would cost to sort of make global industry environment friendly. And his estimate was that it would be an additional 15% of investment if the global investment was 100 billion. All that would be required. It just 15 billion to cure all the ills. We get here, the information that we get here is not true. In the case of just state big fails, they cost us 15 times. And if you look at other items.
If you get 4 million bricks,
I see. Well, then of course, if it's 4 million, then that's the price. That is, well, you see, then another interesting point was made here. It's very interesting to hear now, after so many years, that we must understand and take for granted that there are limits to growth. I think it was in the very one of the very first statements. There is a limit up to which you can go. It all takes us back to theories about the carrying capacity of the world, which was a very important concept in the later part of the. It started from the 1880s, 1883 in particular, and continued till about immediate post-World War discussions. And that was a very basic question, that what is the capacity of the world? How much can it, how much population can be sustainable? You cannot target the good things of life that is enjoyed by developed countries of today. No, it will not be possible to have them. This is limits to growth. So you have to cut down your kind of aspirations. What role could the developed countries play there? What kind of cut down they should be accepting for themselves? Because if mankind is to survive, you cannot continue with the current consumption levels. The consumption levels have to be defined, and this is what we shall go, nothing more. Now, very difficult decision, and particularly difficult for those who have the means not to follow it. I'm reminded of a debate I entered into in 1971 with a gentleman in an international club in Washington, where he said that, well, just because you want to develop yourself, you can't expect to cut down. Well, I am not really commenting on your seminar. I'm just trying to give some ideas for future debate and for future perception of where we are moving, where we can go, and in this movement, what kind of relationship we can have between the rich and the poor, between the north and the south, you see. The terms which you don't use these days, you see, they're all gone. With the sort of end of, idealistic division of the world, which began in 1989, with the fall of the Berlin Wall. We don't talk about these things, but they are real issues, you see. They are not issues to be brushed aside. These require to be discussed, unpleasant it may be, but they should be raised, you see. And that's all that I intend to do today, just raise these issues for further discussion and kind of keeping them in purview, you see, in the purview of what can be said that we are trying to become a middle-income country. Our target is not low middle-income, but middle-income countries. And but that, if you look at the global standards, that's a long way to what is called the reaching the status of a developed country. Our Prime Minister, of course, has been very bold and suggested to us that we should aspire for it to 2042, 2041. I don't know what would be the outcome of this ambition. But at least we have met her particularly ambition when she gave out in 2008 that we should be a building country by 2021. So one can think that then the next election might also be quite genuine and we may reach there. But once we reach that level, then it is very hard and smart. We would be also threatened by option that where do you go next? I mean, you remain satisfied with the standard that you fix for the developed countries they should have. Would you do that yourself? And would the things that we are saying now, 40 years later, whether our future generation would be also guided by this kind of thought, they would have some more moderate views about how the world can survive, and becoming basically world will not be severely threatened. But that probably is resolvable, because with the population growth rate and consciousness about population planning, perhaps we can think that the total population of the world will also stabilize at a similar figure. We are about
9 billion.
9 billion. Yes. We are at 7 billion. So we can be stabilizing at about 9 billion. These are targets which involve sacrifices, and that we must be conscious about it. Sacrifices in terms of the levels that you want to achieve, and sacrifices that you cannot match the standards that are prevailing at the moment in the consumption-oriented societies. Well, I have, as far as this subject is concerned, it would be very important to get a definition of what is being developed. Because we don't have an industrial policy which we can call to be a green industrial policy. We have mentioned certain things that, well, we should take care of the environment this way and that way. But this is only a small part of the industrial development policy. In the industrial development policy, we are still guided by the objective of having more goods for consumption, greater employment for people, because I mean, it is obvious that unless you have industrial growth, there is no solution to the problem of employment that this country faces, you see. We have done pretty well with the employment problems, but what is called small loans and self-financing projects of individual entrepreneurs, that is not what we will said will be dependent on the state. So prospects for Bangladesh are quite good, fairly propitious it looks, you see. But if you take the whole globe, I don't think I can be that much optimistic. And I should like to end here, not only, don't take your pessimistic side strongly, because as far as we are concerned, we are very optimistic. We will be really in a good boat. But again, old theories, you see, what is it? How much the boat can get in. That is an abundant idea. And that has no reason to come back again. The boat is for the humanity, it's for humanity. There is no question of living out some in the mouth of this boat. We have to think about the whole world that way. And there, very difficult choices come about the world, you see. I think I have pointed out what I feel like, and I leave it to you to carry on the discussion and debate over the years to come. Thank you.